polynomial, that is how to use Lincoln list for the polynomial representation and how to do different types of polynomial operations. That is, we can add two polynomials or multiply like that. Okay, so first we will see the polynomial representation, how to represent the polynomial by using a Lincoln list. Okay, so for that I will take some simple example. Four x cubed plus 6x squared plus 7x plus 9. Okay, so how to represent this polynomial? So there are two methods. Okay, the first one is array representation. Okay, and then second one is linked list representation. Okay, so how do you store this polynomial in an array?
Zeroth element for x power 0 coefficient like that.
Okay, so that is we are going to use the index as a coefficients. Okay, that is if the coefficient is a 0, then that corresponding, sorry, if the exponent is a 0, then the corresponding coefficient will be in the 0th place. Okay, so here we are going to use the exponents as an indexing. Okay, so here 9, this is an the coefficient of the exponent 0. Okay, and this is 1, this is 2 and 3 and so on. Okay, so here we have the array. Okay, so the first coefficient is 9. Okay, its exponent is 0, so that's why it is placed in 0th place. Okay, and then 7, and then 6, and then 4. Okay, so here the exponents are arranged from 0 to higher value. Okay, that is higher degree. Okay, and then the coefficients is nothing but an array elements. Okay, so here how many bytes do you need? So here we have only the integer. Okay, so 2 bytes per integer, so totally we have 8. Am I correct? 8 bytes. Okay, so this is one possible way for representing this polynomial. Okay, you consider the polynomial 2 power 10 plus x squared. So how to represent this polynomial by using array? So what we have done here, we have used the exponents, okay, as an array indexing. Okay, and here the exponents are arranged from lower value to higher degree. Okay, so here also we are going to do the same thing. So here we need to start with 0, that is indexing starts with 0 and it is increasing sequentially. Okay, so what is the first value? Is there any value in 0th location? There is no value because we don't have any coefficient for the exponent x power 0. Okay, so in the next, that is a value 1 will be stored in the second place. Okay, and then how many bytes we need to have, that is how many locations do we need to have? 11. Okay, that is a starting from 0 to 10. So we need to have 11 array elements, okay, in order to represent this polynomial. Okay, so here how many bytes? So totally we have 11 elements. Okay, so we need to have 22 bytes. Okay, but among the 22 bytes, okay, we have only two wasteful information. Okay, because in the polynomial we have only two terms. Okay, so this is a wastage of the memory. Okay, so in order to avoid this kind of problems, okay, we are going for the linked list representation. So if you are going to have all the exponents in your polynomial, then we can go for the array representation. Okay, suppose if you are going to have the polynomial with the missing terms, okay, then it is better to use linked list representation. Okay, so how do you represent the polynomial in terms of linked list? So what are the information in the node? Okay, so give me the linked list representation for the first example. What are the information we need to store in a node?
The coefficient and the power.
Yeah, so we need to have the coefficient and the exponent and the pointer to the next node. Okay, so here we have 6, 2, and then it points to the next node, 7, 1, and it points to the next node. So here we have 9, 0, and null. Okay, so here how many bytes we need to have? So per node we need to have 6 bytes, okay, because we have 3 fields. Okay, each field occupies 2 bytes, so 6 bytes per node. Okay, and here we have 4 nodes. Okay, so totally we need to have how many bytes? 24 bytes. Yeah, okay. And then do the same thing for the second example. So in the second example, we are going to have only 2 nodes, okay, because we have only 2 terms in the polynomial. Okay, so 2 and then exponent is 10 and it points to the next node, and here we have 1, exponent is 2 and null. Okay, so 6 bytes per node, we have only 2 nodes, so we are going to have 12 bytes. Okay, so here we have 12 bytes, in the array representation we have 22 bytes. Okay, so if you are going to have the polynomial of higher degree with too many missing terms, okay, then it is better to use the linked list. Okay, so because it we can save more amount of memory. Okay, okay, so how do you define the structure for this node? So what are the information we need to keep?
Coefficient.
Okay.
Coefficient, int, power.
Okay. Int, exponent. Okay.
Then, point it to the next one, node, asterisk. Right.
Oh, exactly. And what is the type of coefficient?
It could be float or int.
Yeah, it may be integer, float or double, whatever it is, okay, you can have it, okay. But the exponent type must be of integer type and next must be of type node, okay. So in this way, we can declare a node if you are going to do the program for polynomial manipulation, okay, with the help of the linked list, okay. Okay, so how do you add the two polynomials? So assume that we have these two polynomials, okay, and we need to add these two polynomials. So what is the procedure we need to follow? So what is the answer for the addition of these two polynomials? We have x power 10 plus 4x cube plus 7x squared plus 7x plus 9, okay. So what are the steps we need to follow? And we are going to add these two polynomials using linked list.
Exponent equal to, if the exponent is the same, then add the coefficient.
Yeah, exactly, good. So first we need to check exponent. If they are matching, we are going to add the exponent. We are going to add the coefficients. Okay, and we are going to use the same exponent. Okay, so here this is in the case of x power 2. Okay, so the coefficients are, exponents are matching. So we have 7x square. Okay, so if it is not.
Now we have to start with the list with the higher power. And like if it's not equal to, then just add the next value.
Yeah, so that is also possible. That is, we need to, if we are going to consider this. So for this polynomial, we have the exponent 10. Okay, so first we have to check. We need to ensure that whether the polynomial is arranged such that the higher degree is appeared first. Okay, so if it is not, we have to arrange the polynomial in such a way that the higher degree appears in the beginning of the list. Okay, that is, the polynomial needs to be sorted in terms of the degree. Okay, so otherwise we have to check this exponent 10 for each and every exponent. Okay, till it matches with some same coefficient, same exponent. Okay, so first we need to ensure that whether the polynomials are arranged or polynomials are sorted in terms of the degree. Okay, so if it is ensured, then we are checking if they are not matching also. We need to, that is, 10 is, whether we need to check whether 10 is matching with 3, 2, 1, 0. So this is not at all matching with any of the nodes. Okay, so we need to keep this entire term. Okay, clear. So otherwise we can do, if the polynomial is sorted, then we are checking with the first node exponent. Okay, so 10 is greater than 3. So we assume that there are no nodes with the coefficient 10. Okay, because we have the first node itself, the exponent is 3. Okay, so there is no node with the exponent 10 after that. So we will keep this term as it is. In the resultant polynomial, we can include 2 into x power 10. Okay, then what we have to do? We have to repeat the same process. And we are saying here 3, and 3 needs to be verified with the second polynomial exponent. If it is not matching, keep it in the resultant polynomial. And here we have the matching exponent, so add the coefficient and keep the same exponent, and so on. Okay, so in this way it is very easy to do the addition. So similarly you can do the multiplication also. Okay, so first we need to get the input, two polynomials in that is a polynomial needs to be in the sorted order in terms of the degree. Okay, and you multiply the two second polynomial with each and every term of the first polynomial. Okay, so multiply the second polynomial with each and every term of the first polynomial. Okay, so once this entire process is completed, again you have to do one more operation, that is we need to check the terms, there is a node with the same exponent. Okay, so if it is the case, then we are going to add the we are going to add the coefficients, and that will be in the resultant polynomial. Okay, so
doubt, ma'am. Mm-hmm. If you have like example 1 and 2, they don't have the terms of same exponent, no? So okay, when you add them, how will you find what answer we have, ma'am? Example, it has 2 power 10 and x square, the second example. The first one don't have x power 10. So how will you add them, ma'am?
Yeah, first we are going to start with any one of the, you keep the either the first polynomial as the starting or second. Okay, so if you are going to consider this node, that is if you are considering the second polynomial, and that needs to be verified with, okay, the first node in the first polynomial. Okay,
okay.
So this is the first node in the first polynomial, and here the exponent is 10. So the corresponding exponent in the first node of the first polynomial needs to be verified. It is 3.
Ma'am, okay. I don't have a problem with that, ma'am. How will we find the number of nodes of answer? That's what I'm asking.
This number of nodes.
For answer, if you add both means, you will get five terms in the answer, no? Add the first exponential, the first polynomial and second one, you will get 5 terms. How will you determine that with that,
program? So if this node is, so you have the pointer for the for these two polynomials, okay? So this is P2, assume then this is P1. So if this node is processed, and don't consider, move to the next node, go to the next node.
Okay.
Okay, and here, first thing is, 10 is not matching with 3, so we have the first term in the resultant polynomial, and move the pointer to the next node. So now this node is pointed by P2. So now you compare both the terms, okay? So both are not matching, that is in terms of exponent. Okay, the first node. So you keep the higher degree exponent in the result.
Okay, ma'am. Got it.
Okay, so once it is processed, go to the next node, P1. So here both are matching, and P2 next is null. So it means that there are no nodes in the second polynomial. So keep increase the P1 one by one till it reaches the last node. Okay, then just add, copy the values in the resultant polynomial.
Okay.
So any other doubts? So I will give you the example for the multiplication also. Okay, you consider the polynomial. This is polynomial P1, and then the next polynomial, consider the polynomial with the two terms. Okay, so how to multiply these two? So just we are going to multiply the second polynomial, okay, with each term of the first polynomial, okay. That is, we are going to multiply 3 into 6, that is 18, okay. And what is the exponent?
3, we just add the coefficients.
Add the exponents, okay. Multiply the coefficients, add the exponent, okay. And the next one is 3 needs to be multiplied with 8, okay. So this is 24, okay, and then this is 2, and we are reaching the null, okay. So now we have considered the first node, move the pointer to the next node, okay. So now multiply 5 with each and every node of P2, okay. So here we have 13, and this is 2, okay, and then 40, this is 1. So we are reaching the end, okay. So move the pointer to the next node. So the coefficient is 6, multiply 6 with 6, 36, and the exponent is 1, okay. And then the next one is 48, 0, and here also we are reaching null. So this is terminated with null, okay. So whether we have completed the multiplication process. So this is an intermediate result, okay. So after this, what we have to do, we have to traverse this entire list and check whether the two nodes are having the same exponent or not, okay. So if they are same, then we have to add the coefficients, then we'll get the final result, okay. So once this entire polynomial is obtained, you have pointed to the first node, okay, and you check the first node exponent with the second node exponent, okay. So if they are different, okay, keep it like this, 3, okay, and now second node with the third node, okay. So the coefficients are exponents are same, so add the coefficient, so we have 54, and we are going to use the same exponent, okay, and similarly 2 with 1, okay, and 1 with 1, so here we have the matching coefficient, sorry, matching exponent, 76, 1, and finally we have 48. Okay, so this is the result.
Ma'am, what if 3 appears somewhere in the middle exponential?
No, what we have assumed, we have two polynomials in the descending order of the exponent. That is, we have to get the input of two polynomials. Okay, so the polynomials are sorted in terms of the degree.
Oh, okay, ma'am.
So if it is ensured, then we are going to have the nodes with increasing a degree. Okay. Clear? Did I answer your question?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so still you have some confusion, tell me, not a problem.
Yes, ma'am. Like say if we have x power 3 and x plus x power 1, okay. Then the next polynomial will be x power 2 and to the left of it x power 8.
Here? This left, here?
Yes, ma'am.
X power 8. Okay, so you multiply these two.
Sorry, make it x power 4, ma'am.
Here?
No, the x power 8 is x power 4.
Okay, so multiply these two. So this is x power 7. X power 3 needs to be multiplied with these two. Okay, and then this is x power 5. Okay, and again, this is x power 5 plus x power. Am I doing correctly? So this is x power 7, x power 5, and this is x power 5, and this is x power 3. Am I correct? So this is first polynomial, and this is second polynomial. This is P1, and this is intermediate result.
Ma'am. If we make x square as x power 1, then it need not be in increasing or decreasing order, no, ma'am.
Here.
If x square is made as x power 1.
Okay. So this is x power 7, this is x power 4, okay, then you have x power 4 and 2.
When we multiply x power 4 with x power 1, it will be x power 5, no ma'am.
X power 7 and this x power 4 and this is x power 5, yeah. X power 5 and this is x power 2. Okay, so this is one list, okay, like this.
So that means it won't be in some specific sorted order, so there might be...
No, so here the coefficient is, exponents are not same, no?
Yeah, not in this case, but...
Yeah, you can display as it is, x power 7 plus x power 5, x power 4, then x power 5, x power 2. It is also possible, and if you are going to display in the sorted order, you have to sort it in terms of degree.
Yes, ma'am, but see, if it is not sorted now, then...
If it is not sorted, you have to do lot of operations. Okay, that is, you have to start from the beginning, means you have to traverse the entire list in order to verify whether the whether you have the matching coefficient, matching the exponent or not. So that is very big problem.
Yes, ma'am.
So if you are going to have only two or three terms in the polynomial, traversing the entire list, it doesn't matter. So imagine if you are going to have 10 terms. No, I didn't get you properly.
Like, you said if 3 is not matching with 2, keep 3 as it is and move to next node, you said no, ma'am.
Okay, here.
So for that, like, we have to check entire list, no, ma'am. Like, not in this case, but we have to check the 3 with every node present
in the entire list. Okay, so for this case it works. Okay, so otherwise you have to check the entire list. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So any other doubts? So I will not be discussing the coding for these operations. It is up to you. So try to write the code. Okay, because if you do this kind of exercise, then you will be familiar with the operation, that is a linked list operations and polynomial operations also. Okay, ma'am. So do it by yourself. Yeah, tell me.
Ma'am, to do multiplication, we can create any number of lists, ma'am. There is no constraint for that.
No. So for the first time, if you are doing means, there is no constraint in terms of the memory. Okay, you can use any number of polynomials. There is any number of linked list. And that too, instead of having this single linked list, you may use a double linked list also. But double linked list, it is not required for this application. So the single linked list is sufficient.
Okay.
Okay. So any other doubts or clarification? We are moving to the next type of application. Okay. Okay, so assume that you have the two numbers m and n. Okay, we have the two numbers. In these two numbers, we are going to have, say for example, some 50 digits. Okay, and here you may have 60 digits. Okay, that is extremely large values. Okay, so you have two numbers. Okay, assume that in the first number you have 50 digits, okay, and then the second number you have 60 digits, okay. So how do you perform the operation on M and N? How do you perform the operation? Say for example, addition or multiplication or subtraction, whatever it is. Any guess? No answer. Say you were guess, it may correct or wrong. Okay, don't bother about it. Okay. Tell me.
In that 50 digits, like if each digit units place, tens place, we can store the place value in one like the exponential thing. and the digit in the another attribute, like in the list, we can create a place value and a digit, and we can point.
Okay, so if it is 50 digit means you need to have 50 nodes, no? Am I correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we are definitely, we are going to use the linked list. You are reaching, nearly reaching the answer. We are going to use the linked list because except the linked list, it is too difficult to add, to perform the manipulation on these two numbers. Okay, so here what we are going to do, we are going to use the linked list, and each and every linked list, so instead of storing a single digit along with its place value, we are going to group some digits. Okay, either for example 4 or 3 or 5, okay, it is up to you. And we are going to represent M in terms of the linked list, and each and every node is going to have some group of digits. Okay, so for this explanation purpose, I will take M as not 50 digits. Okay, so consider this is my M. Okay, and N is like this. Okay, so this is for only for the explanation purpose. The same thing is applicable for this extremely large values. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to extract some group of numbers, digits, okay, and I'm going to place that digits in a single node. Okay, so assume that the number of digits per node is 5. Okay, this is only for the explanation, you may vary this number. Okay, so first I'm going to group 5 digits. Okay, and here the next 5 digits, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so similarly I'm going to do for the next number also. I'm going to group 5 numbers. Okay. So now how to arrange these 5 numbers? That is, I'm going to take these 5 digits, that is starting from the right direction. Okay. So my linked list will be like this. Okay. 3, 1, 4, 1, 5. Okay. And then the next node is going to have the next set of 5 numbers. 1, 1, 2, 1. And then 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, group correctly, 2, 3, okay, not including 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 0, then the next one we are going to have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay, and then 1, this is null, okay, and similarly N will be here, 5, 1, 6, 1, 7, then the next 5 numbers 1, 2, 1, 4, 1, and then 4, 5, 6, 9, 6, 8, 9, and then 2. Okay, so now we can perform the addition or multiplication, whatever it is, between these two nodes. Okay, so once it is completed, move to the next node in both the list and do the operation. Okay, so if we are going to add these two numbers, if there is any carry, then needs to be considered for the next addition. Okay, like that. So once it is obtained, okay, so you have to display the result, okay, from left to right. So here we are taking the numbers from right to left. Moreover, in the group, we have starting from the leftmost digit here. Okay. So here the main concept is, if we are going to have the extremely large numbers, okay, so in order to perform the operations on those numbers, you group the number of digits, so based on any criteria, okay, so group the number of digits and keep only a single group per node, okay, and perform the operation, then you will get the results. Okay, that is, it is easy to do the operations if you are going to have the list. Okay, clear? Okay, so far we have discussed two applications, that is, we have discussed the polynomial arithmetic, and you have the addition of addition or whatever it is. Okay, we have considered the extremely large numbers. Okay, and we can use the linked list for the sparse matrix also. Already we have discussed in the beginning class. Okay, sparse matrix. Okay, because in this matrix we are going to have almost zeros. Okay, so it is better to use the sparse matrix. Okay, in terms of the linked list. Okay, so apart from these three, we can use linked list for the graph representation. So that we are going to discuss in the remaining units. Graph representation or tree representation. Okay, and finally we can use the linked list for the hash table also. So all these, that is, these two will be discussed in the coming units. Okay, in these units we are going to use only the linked list. Okay, in few cases we are going to use arrays. Okay, clear? Any doubts? Okay, so we'll see some other variations of the linked list. So far we have discussed the circular linked list, double and single linked list, and we can have the circular double linked list also. So apart from this, we have the other types also. I'm going to give only few here. Okay, the first one is XR linked list. Okay, so what is the problem in the double linked list? We can traverse in both the directions. If you are going to have pointer to a single node, then it is possible to traverse the entire double linked list in either of the directions. Okay, but the disadvantage is memory. Okay, it needs more memory. Okay, so in order to avoid this problem, that is, in order to reduce the memory requirement, and at the same time we have to go forward and backward direction also. Okay, so for that we can use XR linked list. Okay, that is, whatever the operation we can perform on the double linked list, we can perform it in the XR linked list. Okay, so this is a sample of the single linked list. That is, we are going to have only one pointer field information and the pointer field, similar to the single linked list. Okay, but we can traverse in either way. Okay, so how it is possible? We have the clue here. So what we have done in the single linked list, we have stored the address of the next node. Okay, so in case of XR linked list, okay, we are going to store XR of the previous and the next node address. So you'll see example. So here XR in terms of bitwise, okay, not the logical XR operation. Okay, so this is bitwise XR operation. So if you are going to have this kind of address, then it is easy to do the manipulation with a lesser amount of memory. Okay, so but what is the difficulty in case of XR linked list? So finding this XR. Okay, I think in the, since it doesn't store the actual address, okay, so debugging may be problem. Debugging may be somewhat difficult. Okay, that is, it increases the code complexity. That's it. Okay, so we'll see an example. We have, so first I will write the list, then we'll see the address. So assume that you have four nodes. So this is information field, okay, and here we are going to store the link information. Okay, so I don't use the next as a field name, okay, because we have studied next as a pointer to the next node. So just I'm going to use the word link. Okay, so what is the link of A? So this is nothing but XR of previous and next node. Okay, so what is the previous node for this? It is null. Okay, so the link of A is nothing but, okay, the previous node is null, XR operation, the address of B. So we need to know the address of B, okay, for this operation. Okay, so once you have the single linked list and from in the double linked list, and you know the address of B. Okay, so once it is known, you convert it into XR. Okay, so by having this XR operation, you will get the link information. So that will be stored here. Okay, and similarly, what is a B? So this is XR operation of the previous and next node. So previous node is A and the next node is C. That is, so you need to have the address of previous node and this is XR with address of C. Okay, and then similarly for C, the same thing, B and D. Okay, and for D, how to find out the link information? The previous node is a C. Okay, and what is the next node? It is null. Okay, so by having this, you can get the link information for all these four nodes. Okay, and once it is known, then we can perform the traversal in both the directions. Okay, so it is not possible to have null here. Okay, because we have performed the XR operation with the C. Okay, so we have some non-null information. Okay, clear? So this is the way of using the XR. So now we'll see some properties of XR and we'll go for the operations, that is how to traverse from left to right or right to left, like that. Okay, so the what are the properties of XR operation? So whether we'll get the same answer, that is XR is commutative one. Okay, and then the next one is, it is also associative. Okay, so already you know what is associative property. You will get the same answer. Okay, and then if you are going to perform the XR operation with zero, then you are going to have the value itself. Okay, and if you are going to perform the XR operation between the same value, we'll get zero. Okay, clear? So we are going to use these things, and one more thing is one more property, so that we are going to use here. If you are going to have the XR between A and B, and this is again XR with B. Okay, so from these two we can get. Okay, so B XR with B is zero, and zero is XR with A. Okay, so we'll get A. Okay, so now how to traverse from left to right? So assume that you are currently in C. Okay, so how to traverse from left to right? That is, we need to traverse in this direction. Okay, so assume that you are currently in C. Okay, and C has the link information as the XR of address of B and D. Okay, so how to get the address of the next node? So X this link, so the next address is nothing but the previous node address. So what is the previous node address? Previous node is B. Okay, and then this is XR with the link pointer of the current node. What is the link pointer of the current node? Link pointer of the current node is address of B. Sorry, this is XR operation. And here this is address of C. Okay, so we know the property. Okay, so address of B, XR with address of B, XR, address of C. Okay, so these two are cancelled. So the next node address is simply address of C. Okay, so that is, what is the meaning is, if you know the link pointer and if you know the previous node address, okay, then it is possible to have the address of the next node. Okay, so whenever you are going to construct the list, you have to keep the previous address node. Okay, then it is possible to find out the link information. Okay, so how to traverse from right to left? So assume that you are currently in C. Okay, so how to get the previous node address? So in this case, what we have used, in order to get the address of the next node, okay, we have used the previous node address. Okay, so now we want to find out the previous node address. Okay, so what we have to use? We have to use the next address. okay, and the current link information. Okay, so what is the next node? That is D. Okay, and what is the current node link information? This is XORed with B, D. Okay, so just I am writing the name, information name. So this is actually the address. Okay, so if you are going to perform the XOR on this, okay, then you will get the address of B. Okay, so this is nothing but the previous node. Okay, so by having this XOR information, it is possible to traverse from left to right and right to left. Okay, that is whatever the benefits that you can get from the double linked list, it is possible to get it from the XOR linked list. Okay, so in this way we can save the memory, but the code complexity is increased. Okay, so since we don't have the exact next address information, we need to have the XOR operation, then we have to find out the link information. So if you are going to do some simple mistake, then we will not get the expected result. So we'll see the code for the traversal, then it will be more clear to you. Okay, so assume that you have the node structure as we had for the single linked list. Okay, so this is the list pointer. Okay, and the previous is, so initially the previous is null. Okay, and you have the next info pointer also. Okay, so we need to have these three. So if request, you use some other concept and you may increase the number of pointer variables also, but we need to traverse the XOR linked list, that's it. Okay, so we are going to start with the current node, that is we are going to repeat the sum of the stems which is not equal to null. Okay, so how to start, that is we are going to assume that the list points to the first node. Okay, so we are going to display the first node information. Okay, that is the current node information is displayed. Okay, so in this case A is displayed. Okay, and we need to go to the next node. Okay, so what is the value of next? So this is nothing but XOR of the previous node. Okay, and the current node link information. Okay, so here XOR is a user defined function that you have to define by yourself. Okay, that is you have to perform the bitwise operation between these two values. Okay, so actually these two values are nothing but addresses. Okay, so you have to perform the XOR operation on these two, and this function returns the next value. Okay, that is address of the next node. Okay, so now we know the next node address. Okay, that is we are in B. Okay, so then we need to change the previous and current node. Okay, so what is the previous address now? So now we are in B. So if we are in B, we need to know the address of the previous node. So how to get the address of the previous node? So for that, okay, we are going to make the same. So this is current. So initially the current points to the first node. Okay, the initially the current points to the first node. This is not equal to null. Current information is displayed here. Okay, and the next pointer points to the next node. Okay, so now we are going to change the pointers. That is, the current node address is assigned to previous. So now this node is pointed by previous. Okay, and then current equal to next. Okay, so now this node is pointed by current. Okay, so current is not equal to null. Okay, we have some valid information, so condition is true. Display the current information B. Okay, and find the next address. So you will get the address of the next node. So now this is pointed by next. Okay, then assign the current to previous. So now this node is pointed by current. Okay, and this node is pointed by previous. Okay, you have to repeat the same thing. Okay, so till this condition is true. Okay, so after the termination of the while loop, you will get the display of all the nodes. Okay, clear? any doubts? Office all here, I will not going to give the information regarding how to insert, how to delete, like that. Okay, so this is a concept. So if you are interested, you explore this topic by referring some other materials. Okay, and apart from the XR, any doubts?
How will we do XOR operation with null, ma'am?
Null is a zero, no?
Okay, okay.
Okay. Okay, so I will introduce one more list quickly within 5 minutes, then we'll wind up the session. So the next one is multi-linked list. Okay, so till now we have seen the linked list. Okay, that is one-dimensional linked list. Okay, that is each and every node can have either two or one pointer. Okay, so in case of multi-linked list, each node can have any number of pointers. Okay, so if the number of pointer is two, then it is nothing but double linked list. Okay, so if you are going to have more than two, then it is nothing but the multi-linked list. Okay, that is, we are going to embed multiple linked list into a single data structure. Okay, so we'll see. So assume that you have some information, that is roll number, say for example 10, and you have age and you have some total mark. Okay, so similar to this record, we are going to have some other records also. So I will take one more example. 40, that is roll number is 40, age is 16, total mark is 95, and so on. So similar to this, you have some n number of records. Okay, so I want to sort these records based on the roll number, based on the age, and based on the total mark also. Okay, so here I'm going to maintain one list. Okay, so here this first list, so assume that this is the list. Okay, so the first node points to the list which is sorted in terms of the roll number. Okay, and my second node points to the list which is sorted in terms of age. Okay, so this is in terms of roll number and in terms of age and in terms of total mark also. Okay, so what we are going to have, and for this entire list you have some pointer. Okay, so the first node points to the list. Okay, it gives the sorted order of these records in terms of the roll number. Okay, so you consider only these three. The first node should be the second record because the roll number is 5, 17, 98, and it points to the next record, that is 10, and it points to next 40, like this. Okay, and coming to the next list, this is sorted in terms of age. So age is, first one is 16, so we are going to have 16. Okay, then we have 5, 17, that is actually we are going to have all the informations. Okay, then we have 10, 18, 100. Okay, I think this is null. After that, this is null. Okay, so similarly you can sort this record in terms of mark also. Okay, so that list is pointed by the third node of my primary list. Okay, so this is nothing but multi-linked list. Okay, clear? So by using this concept, you can use the sparse matrix representation also. Okay, so but it increases the number of pointers, but the memory is not a constraint. Okay, then you can go for the multi-linked list. Okay, clear? Any doubts? And similar to this, you may have the multi-level linked list also. Okay, so there are several different types of linked list. So if you are still interested, you refer the materials, any online materials. Okay, so any doubts up to this? So in the next class, we are going to start binary trees. That is the next unit. Okay. So if there are no doubts and clarifications, then I will wind up the session now. Thank you, students.
Thank you, ma'am.